Nick, a couple days removed from the end of the postseason run. When you look at this team after, you know, 48 hours, 72 hours after the season comes to an end, what's the thing that you're going to remember about this season?
You know, this one still stings a few days later, and it's going to sting for a while because I really felt that, you know, this team was a character group and a group that really wanted to get better and a group of players that worked towards that and had a real team-first attitude throughout the whole season. And obviously a disappointing finish anytime you make the postseason and you don't win your last game, it's disappointing.
You made maybe one of the most, I don't want to say shocking, but probably eye-raising statements after the game in Game 6. This is you're a coach that has coached in the Kelly Cup Finals. You've gotten a team to the Eastern Conference Finals. You said this is the best room of any team you've coached. That says a lot.
Yeah, I mean, and that's why the disappointment feels even worse. You know, you had such a great group of guys, and like I said, a group that really wanted to get better, you know. And, you know, they really pushed each other every single day on the ice. We had to kick them off the ice at times because they wanted to stay on and do so much extra, trying to prove their individual skills for the focus of the team. And, you know, we had a hungry group of young players that, you know, the young guys were obviously tremendous for us and breeded some of the success we had this year, but they were groomed well with the leadership we had in the locker room.
65% of your offense in the postseason as far as goals scored happened from first-year players. Matt Caria tied for the league lead with rookie goal scorers with 4. Is that too much offense from young players, or, I mean, are you happy the way the veterans responded?
Well, I felt that veterans played well. You know, obviously we needed more goals, so it would have been nice. You know, I mean, they scored, 13 goals in a series in 6 games, and it's going to be tough to win. And, you know, so we could have used some more production that way from some guys. And, you know, we had Eric Kedilis only for 3 games, and he certainly stepped up and had at least, I think he had 3 assists, you know, and played outstanding for us, you know. So we could have definitely used some more production offensively throughout this series to try and move forward.
Hindsight's 20/20. Would you have done anything different?
No, I don't think so. You know, I stand by the decisions that Colin and I made throughout the year, and talking about the big picture, we made some very tough decisions on this hockey team early on, and you know, the names you can bring up are, you know, Clark and Armstrong and Lizak and even Carlander before that. These are tough decisions to make for this organization, and we feel that we did the right thing. And you know, we want to play a certain style of hockey, we want to play a certain way, and we feel it's conducive to winning. Obviously we didn't get the results we were hoping for, you know, but I feel that it is a huge step in the right direction, and it's a group that I think will be able to maintain much of the core moving on to next season.
A little bit to hang the hat on, the fact that 5 years in this league now, the K-Wings have won the North Division 4 of those years.
Yeah, I mean, it was a bounce back year. Obviously last year was a very disappointing year for us and the organization. You know, we wanted to go farther this year, but we made strides in the right direction. We won the North Division again, like you said, for the 4th time, so that was one of the stepping stones we wanted. You know, we're very proud of that. We're proud of the fact that we're in the postseason. Obviously disappointed with the ending, but this group grew throughout the season and, you know, sort of maintained that character all along, and we did it our way. You know, we weren't going to go down to a different level and play a different way. We're going to play our style right to the end.
You look at the Eastern Conference, no team in the top 4 seeds is remaining. And you kind of talked about it. Fans, you know, look at maybe the 2 seed versus the 7 seed and think it's going to be an automatic. The team, and I think not just this team, but all 4 teams that are no longer in the Eastern Conference playoffs were cautiously optimistic, knowing how every team got call-ups at the last minute and how just 12 points separated first from last in as far as 1 through 8 in the regular season.
Yeah, I mean, it was the tightest year that I've been involved in pro hockey and in the chase. And, you know, you look at a team, I think Florida was at least 10 games over 500, and they don't make the postseason, and they're the 9 seed. So the parity was there throughout the year, and throughout the postseason, it's obviously there, and it's proved that. You know, when the 4 lower seeds win, you know, that's not by fluke. There was not a team that you would say, hey, I want to play them. You know, you certainly wouldn't go out and say that because every team was deadly. Every team had strengths and weaknesses. And obviously we came up to a Greenville team that had outstanding goaltending and did a great job throughout the neutral zone, making it difficult to create offense on them.
Before we turn the page and head to 2014-2015, the NHL is still being played. With the teams that are left, any predictions you want to make as far as Stanley Cup goes?
Well, I think the one thing that you have to say is if I pick you, you're in trouble. So it seems to be the way things work. You know, I was all over. I thought San Jose was going to have a great run, and I looked like a genius for the first three games, and falling apart to the fourth ever team to lose in game seven. So, you know, the LA Kings are obviously a team that looks fantastic. I like the Chicago Blackhawks again. Obviously, unfortunately, putting our St. Louis affiliate out in a crazy fashion with winning those four in a row against them after being down 2-0. You know, so I like them on that side. On the other side, you know, I got an advantage of we're doing this after the Boston-Montreal series. But, you know, I like Boston's game. You know, I really felt that, you know, they outplayed Montreal even though they didn't get the results last night. So I would say, you know, Boston, Chicago, and LA are kind of my, you know, that dark horse on that side. So, you know, I'm looking at that, and I'm not great at predicting it because if I cheer for you, you're in trouble. So you don't want that.
I was going to say, you not picking my Pittsburgh Penguins only makes my Pittsburgh Penguins chances higher, and we thank you for that.
It's absolutely true.
Yeah. So let's talk about now, because obviously it's a quick turnaround. It's the nature of the business. You guys, the players start leaving town here in the next couple of days. Some probably have already left. Exit interviews, is it more about this past season or is it more about the future when you guys have that one-on-one?
No, it's certainly critiquing last season, you know, and that's, you know, 95 or 98% of that conversation, you know. The way Colin and I chose to run it this year was with the fact that we asked those players to assess themselves and assess their year, assess anything they wanted to team-wise, and we also asked for feedback on Colin and I. You know, we said, here's your chance. You know, here's your chance to say what you didn't like about us. And, you know, because Colin and I want to critique ourselves, we want to get better. And, you know, I felt that they went well. Everyone said the same thing. You know, every single interview, it came up one way or the other that we were disappointed with the finish. And we felt that there should have been more from us. So that's a disappointing feeling, but all in all, the meetings went very well and very positive. And you know, there's some guys with some decisions they want to make about their futures, and you know, it's a great group that, you know, I would expect to try and bring a lot back.
How much do you have to clear your mind before looking at 2014-15? Because obviously, you're right, you're still in the same week when your season ends. How many days or weeks do you give yourself to erase this year before you focus on next year?
I wish there was time. I don't take much time. You know, we did talk to players, a lot of those players, and we want to put that seed in their head to see what they're doing. You know, so there is part of that conversation where we're asking what the plans are, what your thought process is, and if players don't want to be here and want to move on, we want to help those guys. And you know, we've helped Dean Strong go to Europe, and we've helped those guys. You know, as much as we want to bolster our roster, you know, we want to help the individuals that have been loyal to us and that have worked hard for us. And the more guys we do that with, you know, the happier guys are about playing for you in Kalamazoo or playing for the organization in Kalamazoo, and then it makes it easier to recruit. You know, we're not going to try and hide guys or mess with guys. We want to help them on a serious note on what type of contract works for them, and we've told every single player to call us if they have questions.
How much of that right now, when you're looking at, you know, in the next couple of weeks, next couple of months, when you start to sign guys, depends on your affiliation? When does the affiliation agreements and talks begin?
Well, you know, you usually wait till the team's seasons are over, and obviously Vancouver/Utica, their seasons are over, but they're in a big transition period right now with obviously hunting for a general manager and a head coach in the NHL level. So, you know, I think we're going to have to wait till that happens in that organization before we start to put our step, move forward with them. And then obviously St. Louis's AHL affiliate there, the Chicago Wolves, are still in the midst of the playoffs. So, you know, there hasn't been any talk with them whatsoever. We'll wait till that finishes up and give them a few days, and then start to pick their brains on what's next for us, and you know, look towards that part. You know, I think what I've done in the past, or what we've done here in the past, is we try to build a team regardless of what our affiliation is going to bring in, because you never know. Obviously, they give you great guesstimations and they work hard for you. They're not out to mess with your lineup, so to speak, even though it feels like that sometimes. But they're out to help you, you know, and they can only give you a guesstimation on what number they're going to send. And we have to work towards building a team without them.
Realistically, June, July, that's when the contracts start falling in?
Yeah, I mean, you know, you can sort of talk to guys on a verbal basis. And I guess officially you can't sign players until, I believe it's June 16th. And I'll be honest, I haven't got to the date part of things and how that's going to work yet this year. You know, that'll be next Monday. We'll start opening the book to see when all the rosters have to be in and all those deadlines are. For the end of this year and then the beginning of next.
How much of a recruiting tool can an outdoor game be for next season?
I believe it is a recruiting tool. I mean, who wouldn't want to be part, if you're going to play at the ECHL level, the very first outdoor game in ECHL history? What an outstanding opportunity this is going to be. What a lot of fun it's going to be. I've seen a brief snippet of the schedule around that time, and we're not that busy on purpose. You know, we talked to Jim Berlew, who does a fantastic job with our scheduling, and we want that to be something that we can all enjoy and families can enjoy and people can be part of, because it's something that you may never get a chance to be part of again.
Well, and just on a little bit of a comical note, a little happy, because I know you played at Guelph, and I know that's where those coaching hats kind of came from, so I'm going to assume you have your coaching hat already for December 28th.
So I do have one from back in junior. It did originate, the hat trick, and the Biltmore hat originated in Guelph, Ontario, when you get the hat trick. So when we were playing there and you scored a hat trick in junior, we were allowed to go down to the old school tailor and get fitted for one of those hats. So I'm not sure if it fits me anymore, but I do have it in a box somewhere. And if not, if that one's still in rough shape, maybe we'll have to go out and look for something else.
Nick, always a class act, and we appreciate everything you've done during the season, obviously on the coach, but on the interviews as well as on the radio side of things. And we look forward to talking to you over the summer and, of course, during the 2014-15 campaign.
Well, we want to say thank you to the fan base as well. You know, we appreciate the support we have in Kalamazoo. We know we have the best fans in the league, and they come in day and night, and you know, I've been getting lots of sort of condolences, and one of these times it's not going to be condolences, it's going to be a congratulations for us at the end.